Welcome back, everyone. This is the second video in the series on using Microsoft Excel to create graphs and perform statistical calculations. In part one, you'll learn how to create plots in Excel and perform linear regression and display the R-squared value. In this video, we will describe two more useful processing methods in Excel. The first one is to display more than one data set in a graph, as shown in the plot below. This will be necessary in specific experiments in Chem 11. I will show you how to display multiple datasets using the example below. In this example, we have a reaction between the reactants A and B, making the product C. The concentration of C produced can be measured using a technique called spectroscopy, which is based on the absorbance of light by a chemical species. So to determine how much C is made by a given quantity of A, we measure the absorbance of C. The data we collect here shows how changing the volume of A results in a change in the absorbance of C. The data is split into two parts, the yellow and the blue. The first part of the question asks us to plot these datasets as two separate plots, but display them in one graph. And then the second part of the question asks us to fit each of these data that we plotted with a line and then show the line equation and R-squared values. Now, just like in part one, the steps I'm about to show you are also described in your lab procedure. In this case, in part two, which is titled Two Datasets with Overlay. Again, keep in mind that what I'm showing you is the Excel for Mac version, while the one in your lab procedure is written for the PC version of Excel. Okay, start by typing or copying the data into Excel as you did before. Then generate the scatter plot for just the yellow dataset. This can be done using the steps you learned in the first video. So now you have the first dataset, the yellow one. To add the blue dataset, click inside the graph, then click on Chart Design, and then on Select Data. Click on the plus sign, which will add another series of data. Notice that in this series, the X and the Y values are still undefined, so you will need to fill them in. To add the X value, click inside the X values window, and then highlight the values in the blue data set, left column, right here. Now all the X values are entered. Remember that the left column always corresponds to the X values in Excel. Now, click inside the Y values window, delete all the values that Excel enters by default. Then once the window is clear, highlight the blue dataset right column. Once you have that, click OK, and you will see another scatter plot shown in your graph. The second data points have a different color than the first data point because it's a different set of data. So what you just did is add another set of data to the first one. You can now click on each data set and then fit it with a linear equation and display the R-square, just like we did in the first video. So now this is the completed graph. Okay, once we have the equations in the plot as shown here, we can solve for the last question, which is to find the point of intersection between the two lines using substitution. We let the two equations, both equal to y, equal to each other, and then solve for x, being 1.70 milliliter, which is the volume of A when we have the highest amount of product of C measured in its absorbance. We can then substitute 1.7 into the x variable in one of the equations, and solve for y equal to 1.76, being the absorbance of the product C at its maximum point. Okay, now we've come to the last part of the Excel video. Here I want to discuss how to use Excel to make various calculations, in this case, specifically in calculating statistical quantities. Let's first discuss why we want to do this. Experimental data are usually measured several times, so we can be confident of the result. Instead of showing all the data, usually what scientists do is calculate the average of the repeated measurements. There are two types of averages that can be calculated. The mean is also called the arithmetic average and has the symbol x bar. The mean is calculated by adding all the individual measurements, symbolized here by x sub I, and then dividing that by the total number of measurements, symbolized by n. Another type of average is the median. This is a number that is obtained by first ordering all the data from smallest to largest, then take that number that is exactly right in the middle of this numerically ordered set. to be the median. If two numbers are right in the middle, take the mean of the two numbers to be your median. In addition, a quantity called standard deviation is also calculated. Standard deviation provides a measure of spread of the data around the average. A more precise data will scatter less, while a less precise data will scatter more around the mean. This can be illustrated using a histogram or a plot of the data distribution. In the distribution shown, you see that the data set on the left has less spread around the mean, which is shown in the black line right here, compared to the one on the right. So the left data set has a lower standard deviation or higher precision compared to the data set on the right. This spread can also be shown in a scatter plot from Excel, as shown in this plot. Here you have two data sets, 1 and 2. The one on the left has a larger spread than the one on the right, so the left data set is less precise. The actual value of standard deviation can be calculated using a formula that I show here. You will take each of your individual measurement, x sub I, and then subtract it from the mean, or x bar, and square that difference. You will then add all of those square of the differences and then divide by n minus 1. Lastly, you will take the square root to give you the standard deviation. One more thing to point out is the existence of outliers, which are data points that are outside the range of the normal data. One way to determine that a point is an outlier is by finding out if its value is beyond 2 times the standard deviation plus minus the mean. Okay, let me show you how to do all of these calculations that I just discussed. First, we're given a data like this, and this data is on the scores of various students on the first exam. We can use Excel to calculate the mean, median, and standard deviation after we enter this data. Okay, once we enter the data, for mean, what we need to do is enter a function in Excel to calculate that value. To do this, type equal average, and then parentheses. Inside the parentheses, put the highlighted values of all the data points, which is these guys right here. Excel has a series of pre-programmed functions, and the function average is used to calculate the mean of a collection of data. If you press enter, you get the mean. Now again, keep in mind that this is calculated value, and so it doesn't reflect significant figures. So if these happen to be measured values, you're going to have to think about how to write the correct significant figures. For median, we're going to do the same thing, except that the function we will use, it's called median. Put the parentheses, and then inside the parentheses, you would highlight all the data points again. Press enter, and you get the median. Lastly, for standard deviation, you would type equal, and then STDEV, parentheses, and then inside the parentheses, highlight all the data points as you did before. Press enter, and you get the standard deviation. Now note that you should also calculate each of these quantities, mean, median, and standard deviation, using your calculator on a scratch paper. And what you should get at the end is the same exact results as the values that we just obtained here through Excel. Now, I want to show you how to graphically show the spread of the data. To do that, what we need to do is just plot the data. Now, all of these are the scores of exam 1, so for the x values, we're going to enter 1 for all of them, and then the y values are different exam scores. When we plot the data using the methods we learned from before, you can see now that the exam scores has a large spread around its mean of around 68, which is right here. Okay, so that shows you the spread of the data graphically. The last part is to determine if there are any outliers in this data. Remember what I said earlier about outliers. We do this by calculating the range of data within 2 standard deviations from the mean. So to do that, what we need to do is calculate the value of mean minus 2 times the standard deviation, and then the value of mean plus 2 times the standard deviation. We can do that in Excel, and I'm going to just show you real quickly how to do that. We say equal the value of the mean, which is here, so we'll just click on that. That will tell you that E3 is the cell that contains the mean, minus 2 times, which is the asterisk symbol, the standard deviation. Press enter, and you get this value. So that's the value of mean minus 2 standard deviation. We calculate the same thing here for mean, which is this value, plus now 2 times standard deviation, and we get a value of 106.5. And so what that tells us is that the acceptable data for this experiment is anything between 30.5, if you round that to one decimal, which matches the data. Remember that you have to match the significant figures of the data. So 30.5 to 106.5, that's the range of acceptable data. Anything less than 30.5 or anything more than 106.5 are considered outliers. So if we look in our data set and look for values that are smaller than 30.5 or bigger than 106.5, we found that there's only one, and that is this number right here, 26. So in that case, that number is an outlier in our score. It's so much lower than what we expect to see for the exam score. Okay, so this ends our discussion on how to use Excel for graphing and calculating statistical quantities. You can now use the information you just learned to complete the lab procedure and the lab report for the graphing with Excel experiment. I would just point out one thing here, which students often miss, which is the significant figures. So remember that Excel gives you a lot of digits, but what you want in the end is the correct value should match the data itself. So in this case, this should be 30.5 and this should be 106.5. So that these two are the correct values given the precision of your data. Okay, if you have any further questions, we will meet in lab to discuss this experiment.